Author Joel Rosenberg's new novel, The Persian Gamble, could be his most thrilling one yet. CBN's George Thomas interviewed Rosenberg recently about his book and about his meeting with President Trump.
Joel, tell us about your new book, The Persian Gamble, and can Marcus Riker save the world?
I hope he can, because it's pretty dangerous. Here's what I said to President Trump when I met him last week, was he asked me for the elevator pitch for The Persian Gamble. I said, okay, Mr. President, what if the Iranian regime takes the $150 billion that President Obama gave them for the insane Iran nuclear deal, which, thank God, President Trump scrapped. But what if they took the $150 billion and went secretly to North Korea and tried to buy off the shelf fully operational nuclear warheads? And the president said, wow, well, how do you know they're not doing that already? Yeah. And I said, well, I'm hoping and praying and trusting that you and the men in this Oval Office are working every day to make sure the Persian gamble never comes true. But this is actually the real danger. North Korea has up to 60 nuclear warheads that we know of. They've got ICBMs that can reach Los Angeles. What they don't have is cash. Their people are starving. They're bankrupt. Iran has cash, but they don't have nuclear warheads, and they don't have ICBMs yet. So that's my concern, and the concern at the heart of the Persian gamble is, what if Iran uses their cash to buy North Korean weapons? And that would be incredible.
Iran and North Korea, and how dangerous this alliance is.
Yeah. Look, on the face of it, Vladimir Putin, the dear leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un, and the Ayatollah Khamenei in Iran seem like the least likely three people on the planet to get together. Their political philosophies are completely different. Their religious theologies and eschatologies are completely different. And yet, what brings them together? Their hatred for the United States and the West. And that is binding them together in an alliance where they're helping each other with weapons and technology and political support. And my fear is, and certainly the basis of these political thrillers, is that while Russia, I think under Putin, thinks that he can manage these two rogue regimes, I don't think they're manageable. And I think particularly Iran is likely to go off in a direction and pull Russia and North Korea into some dangerous confrontation with us that Putin would just not understand the concept.
You recently had a chance to meet with Jason Greenblatt. I know that a lot of what you guys discussed was off the record, but can you tell us what the plan is on the record that he put forward?
Well, no. But what I can say is I spent 4 hours at the White House last Thursday and walked through... It was less about them explaining what they're doing as wanting to hear what are concerns of evangelical leaders about a Middle East peace initiative. What would be some of our red lines? You can understand that many of us are very concerned and we do not want to see Jerusalem divided, for example. And we are not sure that the Palestinians have shown any capability for running a two-state scenario. But what I said to the vice president and to Jason and to others was... this I can say is what I said to them. Listen, I don't support those divisions. However, President Trump is already on record as saying he, in theory, could support a two-state solution if the two parties can figure out a way to make it work, and that the boundaries of Jerusalem are open for negotiation. Now, we would be uncomfortable as evangelicals if we thought it was really going to happen tomorrow, but Palestinian leadership has no interest at all in making a final deal. But who does? The Saudis, the Bahrainis, the Emiratis, the Omanis, the Gulf states want to make peace. So my encouragement would be that President Trump would have in his final document some of this language, which has a lot of caveats in it, but still opens the door for the countries that want to make peace, the Gulf states, even though Abu Mazen and the Palestinians, sadly, have no interest in making peace whatsoever.
We have less than a minute here. You used to be a never-Trumper. What happened? What changed?
Well, I told President Trump in the Oval Office that I was a never-Trumper until the Thursday before the election. And he said, well, what happened Thursday? I said, well, we had to make a decision in Jerusalem, send in our ballot. I was not sure I could trust the president, then Mr. Trump, not president yet, if he would keep his conservative promises. But I told him, thank you. You have scrapped the Iran nuclear deal. You've been the most pro-life president, most pro-Israel president, most pro-growth president in the history of the country. I misjudged you, and you know, I didn't get into all the tweets and other things that I would disagree with him on. But the point is, he's made big strides. He's kept his word, and he should be encouraged by that. And we should encourage him, even those of us who were opposed to him for a long time.
Terrific. Joel, as always, sir, thank you for coming on the show.
Great to be with you, George.
Appreciate it. Alpha Omega.